Thank you so much, Paul. It's a pleasure, absolute pleasure to be here. And I thank everyone who's out there and spending your valuable time with me. So good afternoon, good morning, good evening, depending on what time zone you're in. So I am Dr. Peter Bongiorno. I am a paid medical advisor for Pure Encapsulations. I have no other conflicts or of interest to disclose. So why do we need sleep? You know, years ago, it wasn't really well understood what sleep played in terms of our health. Some people actually thought we didn't even need sleep because it was so unclear. But now, you know, with available research, we know a lot about sleep. We know all animals, including human animals, certainly require sleep. We know that animals, including rodents and humans, will die if we don't get enough sleep. And the amount of sleep varies depending on the particular studies. It seems that humans can't go more than 11 days without sleep. About 30 to 50% of Americans have suffered from acute insomnia, and about 10% currently have insomnia, chronic insomnia, at any given time. So what is it about sleep? Well, we know a few things about sleep. We know that sleep is when our body repairs things, right? We know that sleep is when our body detoxes. So without those mechanisms, we know that sleep is when the slow wave peristalsis of the stomach really comes into play and really fixes the linings of the digestive tract. We know that's when the mitochondria, you know, break themselves apart and put themselves back together in a way that helps create better mitochondria that can effectively serve our bodies in a better way. So sleep has many, many functions, not one. We know that when we don't get enough sleep, blood sugar is dysregulated, weight gain becomes more of an issue, mood disorders become more of an issue as well. So there's so many reasons why we need sleep. Okay. So we're going to talk about a case study, which we'll talk about peppered throughout the webinar. We'll talk about some medications, patient intake, lab testing, putting a plan together, and get back to the case recommendation a little bit more at the end. So we'll talk about Charlotte, who's 45 years old, very difficult falling asleep, wakes throughout the night, can't get back to sleep, but falls asleep in front of the TV around 10 p.m. She has climacteric symptoms, perimenopausal symptoms. She also has nocturia. About 8 months ago, she realized it's not getting better. So it seems like it was more longstanding, but about 8 months ago is when it kind of hit her, okay, I just can't sleep anymore. She's in the middle of divorce, 3 kids to take care of, financial worries. Like I said, 48 years old, and she finds she's better after she drinks alcohol, which helps her fall asleep. She also notices that she's worse staying asleep after she drinks alcohol. It's worse before her period and before she speaks to her lawyer, which is a time she gets really upset and stressed out. She used to exercise, but now she's too busy. Coffee never bothered her. So she continues to drink those 2 cups in the morning and 1 in the afternoon. And bowel movements are pretty good. No real complaints for her. So what are some of the medications that we use for sleep in conventional care? So conventional primary care and psychiatry has a whole host of medications for sleep. Benzodiazepines, which work on the GABA receptor, non-benzohypnotics, also known as the Z drugs, antipsychotics, antidepressants, antihistamines, over-the-counter sleep aids, which could be antihistamines or diphenhydramine. There's newer orexin antagonists like Belsomra. There's also anti-inflammatories and analgesics. And then there's melatonin agonists. And I put the question mark next to analgesics and anti-inflammatories because those aren't typically considered for sleep. But many people find when they use them, they can sleep better, probably because it lowers inflammation. And you know, one of the things that I realized working with mood issues is when there's a lot of medications for a particular condition, it usually means that no medication works best or has some sort of issue, which is why we can't continue to take it regularly. So there's a whole host of medications for sleep. And one of the things about medications, which I think is useful, is when my patients come in, they have sleep issues. They've usually been on medications. And at the very least, medications are very telling in terms of some of the mechanisms going on. You know, because some of my patients will take an antihistamine and tell me that didn't do a thing, whereas other patients will take hydroxyzine and say, wow, that does work really well for me. Or they'll take a melatonin agonist and say that didn't do anything for me, and others will say yes. And the same with the anti-inflammatories. So that gives us an idea about some of the mechanisms we might need to work on. So if an anti-inflammatory works for a patient, then we know we really do want to work on inflammation, right? Whereas a benzodiazepine works, but the Z drug doesn't work, then it's probably more of a straight-on kind of anxiety situation. So they're all different, and they can all teach us a little bit about the patient, which can help us make better long-term decisions. The problem with medication is that there's a lot of risk. In 2012, a study in BMJ looked at about 30,000 people, found a 300% increased risk of death, and people took fewer than 18 sleeping pills a year, which is less than two a month. Higher doses were linked with an even greater than 500% increase in death, so about five times the risk. And just to be clear, this study really looked at confounders as well as they could, and were pretty clear that they didn't think there were confounding issues. They looked at other other disease conditions that patients already had, whether they smoked, all and things like that, that would obviously change some of those numbers. And they found that once all those were cleared out, these were the increases that were found, and there was no other explanation other than the medications. So the authors concluded, and this is in 2012, that there may have been an association with 320 to 507,000 excess deaths in the U.S. due to these medications. So, which is fascinating to know that these medications, which can help people sleep, are also creating this kind of mortality. And it's interesting because if you look at other studies on chronic insomnia, people who are unmedicated but have poor trouble sleeping are at no real increased risk of death. So for a few reasons, we have to really question long-term use of medications. Of course, when somebody's suffering, and they need something just to help them feel better, that's, you know, where medications can come in handy. But really looking at the underlying issues in a more functional, holistic, naturopathic way, that's, I think, really what we want for our patients in the long term. Okay, so a little about patient intake. I find patient intake is really where we can figure out how to help. My first visit with a patient's about an hour and a half, and I spend a lot of time asking questions because this is when we can really figure out and craft and curate a recommendation plan that's going to work for our patients in a very individualized way. So we want to ask when it started, you know, what the chronology was, what's going on in their schedule for the day. Are they rushing around and then they, you know, want to go to bed right away because they don't have any more time? As an example, do they have time to sleep enough? Is that really the issue? What do they eat during the day and at what time? There's a very strong relationship between eating habits and schedule and cortisol levels and timing of released cortisol, caffeine, alcohol, and medications. Do they drink enough water? Are they taking vitamins? If so, which ones? Do they exercise? When do they exercise? Of course, what are their stressors? What rituals do they have before bed? What are their partner's rituals before bed? Because certainly what's going on in their environment can affect their sleep. What time do they go to bed and wake up? Is the room dark and quiet? Is the room cool? And what kind of bed are they sleeping on? Are there a lot of electromagnetic frequencies around them? Is there mold exposure in their home? Do they snore? Has anyone told them they snore? So getting the answers to these can help us really craft an excellent recommendation plan that'll be specific for that patient. I'm not sure why I can't sleep. Maybe it's the bed. So definitely look around when you talk to your patient. So lab testing. So in the interest of brevity, we're not going to go through every lab test. But what I wanted to say is that looking into the various reasons why a patient can't sleep, we really want to look at all different types of testing, urine testing, blood testing, genetic testing, looking at stools. And that's where the intake comes in handy, because we're not going to look at every test for every patient. I'd love to do that, but it's a lot of testing. But what we can do is try to get an idea about what's going on for this patient, like the patient Charlotte we talked about. Clearly, there was more of a hormonal issue. So some of the blood tests will focus on hormones. The urine test might focus on hormones. And for her, it didn't sound like a stool test were as needed. So as an example. As a Chinese medicine practitioner and acupuncturist, I like to look at tongues. Oftentimes, the tongues can tell us a lot, especially about digestion and overall body energy, where sometimes regular testing doesn't quite do that. The patient here on the left has a very, what they would call yin deficient tongue with cracks, a very deep crevice in the center, suggesting mood issues. The tongue in the middle looks more like a candida, very pale, low energy kind of tongue. The tongue on the right is a very candidal tongue. So they tell us different things about digestion and how to help based on what we see on the tongue. So that is something that if it's something you haven't really looked at, I highly recommend it. You know, in Chinese medicine, we look at pulses, we feel pulses, and we look at tongues. The pulse tells you what's going on with the energy in that moment with the patient, and the tongue looks at the over time what's going on with the patient and their physiology. So it's almost looking at like a fasting blood sugar in the moment versus an A1C that looks over 3 months. So the tongue is more the A1C part of that, and very, very valuable. And honestly, it's as you start looking at every patient's tongue, you'll start to get a real sense of their energy and their vitality, and it really gives a good amount of information. And for sleep, it can be very useful. For example, like when you see a very red tip on the tongue, that suggests in Chinese medicine there's yin deficient energy, and the energy is rising up. And in Chinese medicine, that's a reason why it comes up at night and the person can't go to sleep. So what are my favorite lab tests? I like looking at cortisol, serum, urinary saliva, especially a good 4 or 5 point cortisol test, melatonin, urinary melatonin, iron and ferritin, plus the other iron indices, red blood cell magnesium, inflammatory markers, estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, look at histamine levels, and also look at some genetics, for example, COMT and MAO, probably some of my favorites. And actually we have actually past webinars where I speak on those. So if you're interested, you could take a look at that as well. So those are some of the tests, and there might be others depending on the intake with the patient, but these would be the core for most patients. For our patient Charlotte, we found that her cortisol was very low in the morning, was very low in the afternoon, but coming up, and then went high at night and overnight. Very typical dysregulated circadian pattern. Her estrogen was out of range. Her progesterone was very low normal compared especially to estrogen. Her ferritin was low normal. Her TIBC was high, but iron was still in the normal range, which sometimes I think gets missed. You know, we see this low normal ferritin, whereas the iron is still in normal range, and we don't really consider that iron deficiency, where many patients still might be. The COMT was considered the slow type, meaning the allele and the polymorphism that doesn't allow for a proper breakdown of catecholamines and estrogens, probably leading to the higher estrogen levels. The CYP1A2, which is the one that metabolizes things like caffeine, was also a risk variant, meaning that they probably don't do as well with caffeine and that it stays in the system longer. And caffeine, of course, when it comes to sleep, is an issue because it binds to adenosine receptors, right? Adenosine receptors are there to, when ATP from energy, you know, breakdown gets broken down, that binds to adenosine, we get tired. So when caffeine is around, it binds to those receptors, and people who have this variant are going to be more at risk of that and have longer term issues with caffeine. And then her tongue, like we saw earlier, was more of a yin deficient red tip tongue. So, so we did the intro, the medications, patient intake, lab testing. Now we're going to start putting a plan together. So what is the general plan to work on sleep? We want to work on sleep time and rituals. We want to help people exercise, look at their environment, relaxation and psychological work, foods and food timing, digestion, and supplements. And I'm just, apologize. Just looking for my timepiece so I could stay on time. Okay, so what about sleep timing? So we want to make sure that we ask the patient about their nighttime rituals. You know, are they staring at screens right before bed? Are they looking at horror movies? Are they reading, you know, who knows what's going on? But anything we can do to calm and have patients maybe an hour before bed start to wind down, shut the lights. I have patients often use an orange light bulb because orange does not suppress melatonin the way the other colors after orange do. So red and orange are the best, but red is hard to read by. So orange, at least you can still see and read. Keeping the room dark, optimal sleeping temperatures around 68 degrees, making sure patients have a sleep schedule. We'll talk more about that in a bit. Do they need a to-do list? You know, some patients are so stressed out and thinking about the next day. I know for me, that's very helpful for my sleep, making sure I write down all the things I know I want to do tomorrow. So this way I could put it to the side and say, okay, it's here. I don't have to think about it. I'm going to bed. And then food is another one. It should be on a separate bullet line there. Should they eat? Do they need to stop eating? We'll talk about that in a minute. Nighttime exercise, is that a good idea? Or is it better during the day? We'll talk about that in a minute. And I like to tell my patients to remember that they are a sleeper. And some people might have long-term sleeping issues, but I remind them that their physiology and their body is made to sleep and that they've done it before and they will do it again. And that there are very few people in the world who have a genetic issue where they actually can't sleep, but that's exceedingly rare. I've never seen that in my practice. So most people are sleepers. We just need to figure out what the factors are that's stopping them from doing that. So exercise has been well shown to significantly improve sleep quality. So when people exercise to their ability, sleep gets better. No question about that. Is exercising at night a good idea? Well, it depends, right? So this particular study from 2019 was a meta-analysis of 23 studies, and they found that evening exercise, despite the myth, overall helps sleep. However, sleep latency, total sleep time, and sleep efficiency might be impaired ending less than an hour before bed. So evening exercise is good, but exercise right before bed, probably because norepinephrine goes up, is still not a good idea. So it's fine to exercise during the day. That's what my preference for my particular body. But even in the evening, it's okay, as long as it's not right before bed. Environment. I know we talked a little bit about mold earlier, so I won't mention that again. This is one study of a fellow from a pet food company who found that he had severe sleep, he had sleep apnea with all of these nasal symptoms and conjunctivitis, and found that it normalized with vacation. And when they gave him a challenge, they found that the guar gum that was in the air of his plant where he worked was probably the reason and why he had those symptoms and had poor sleep. So again, asking patients all of these questions, what's going on in their environment, maybe getting an air filter could be valuable to some patients. Bisphenol A and obstructive sleep apnea. What we're finding is that for patients with obstructive sleep apnea actually have higher levels of bisphenol A in their urine, also show typically higher levels of parathyroid hormones and lower levels of vitamin D. So even though that's not something we think of in relationship to sleep, that is something to check out. And I've seen higher parathyroid levels, they're going to have more digestive issues, typically more esophagitis, more intestinal problems as well. And of course, we might see higher calcium levels and we'll see those lower vitamin D levels. And checking the low vitamin D levels without knowing the parathyroid might be a mistake, because then we won't know why the body is suppressing vitamin D levels. So maybe in that particular case, just giving vitamin D levels, especially if calcium is already high, might not be the best for the patient. Mold illness, dampness and mold at home. So here's a study talking about dampness and mold and its relationship to insomnia symptoms, snoring, and excessive daytime sleepiness. So something to think about as well. And I know mold illness is definitely becoming more and more on the forefront. And I think there's a good reason for that. Of course, psychological work, something I didn't stress here, because from a functional medicine standpoint, there's so much to talk about. But anyone who's stressed out and is not sleeping, in my opinion, should be getting some good quality therapy, possibly CBT work. And this, here's one study here that looked at CBT versus one of the Z drugs. And the CBT group spent much more time in slow wave sleep. And interestingly, that one study in the British Medical Journal that we talked about earlier, looking at the high risk of using these drugs, showed that the Z drugs were probably the most risky of them all, which included a 35% increase in cancer risk as well over 5 years. So CBT does not have that increased risk. So what about food? We want to check a few things. We want to make sure patients are drinking enough water, which is really important for tryptophan absorption into the brain, which we need to make serotonin. We want to make sure they're having good protein sources like cold water fish a few times a week. Keep the glycemic load low. Keep the protein levels on the higher side. Oatmeal is an herb called the Vena sativa, well known to be really nourishing and calming for the nervous system. Almonds and pomegranates are also known to be anxiolytic and helpful with calming the nervous system. Food allergies and sensitivities, if we see that in patients and it's driving inflammation, that might be useful. Also avoiding the typical things that could keep us up, chocolate, caffeine, alcohol. I know for me personally, red wine is an issue, and I'll wake up in the middle of the night feeling very dehydrated and with palpitations. So clearly it's raising some stress hormones there for me. And then what about the Mediterranean diet? The Mediterranean diet is so well researched these days, and it's even been shown for sleep to help higher sleep efficiency, less sleep disturbances. And when people ate plenty of fruits and vegetables, they also predicted a lower score of sleep quality problems and sleep disturbances. And they found that higher legume intake predicted better sleep efficiency. So fruit, vegetables, and legumes seem to be the parts of the Mediterranean diet that are most beneficial when it comes to sleep. Speaking of coffee. So meal timing, is it a good idea to stop eating early? Well, this one study of 793 participants from 2020 showed that eating within 3 hours of bedtime was positively associated with nocturnal awakening. So when people had a large meal within 3 hours of bedtime, they had more trouble sleeping. So generally, we do tell patients don't eat a meal right before bed. Having said that, there are some people who actually do better if they sleep. And this particular study from 2021, so only a year earlier, showed that shifting dining time from 5 hours before sleep to 1 hour in healthy volunteers did not result in adverse changes in overnight sleep. In fact, the later dinner was associated with deeper sleep in the beginning of the night and lighter sleep in the latter part of the night in healthy volunteers. So that's important to remember. What I find clinically is there are patients whose blood sugar tends to drop during the middle of the night. For whatever reason, their liver is not releasing bits of sugar as it's made to do, all right, from glycogen storage. So for those patients who are waking, sometimes I find keeping a little blueberries on the side of the bed or even, you know, and having them when they wake up and then they try to go back to sleep, or even doing a little bit like a slice of turkey and a flax cracker, or maybe some almond butter on that flax cracker, a little something before bed just to kind of help their blood sugar stay a little more stable. And many of those patients either are having a dysregulated cortisol or they're having dysglycemias where the insulin levels are bouncing up and down, and that's dropping their blood sugar So working on those issues, and in the meantime, maybe giving them a little something before bed that's complex carb and protein and fat might be helpful to stabilize their blood sugar during the night. Poor diet and digestion is also gonna increase sleep issues. The digestive system is bidirectionally attached to the brain via the vagus nerve. There's a lot of gut-brain communication going back and forth, especially through the things that the microbiome create in there and go back into the brain, tell the brain what to do, and then the brain changes behavior and tells gut what to do, and we end up with this back and forth that can create sleep issues. Sleep issue disturbances result from inappropriate lifestyles, incorrect dietary habits, and or digestive diseases. Patients with inappropriate dietary habits and chronic digestive disorders sleep less and show lower sleep efficiency compared with healthy individuals. So when you hear that there are sleep issues, if you suspect that there's a microbiome that's very imbalanced, absolutely that is something to test and something to work on. In terms of the microbiome and sleep, it's important to remember that the microbiome is a very important part with the liver in working on the central hepatic clock gene expression. So when the gut microbiota are out of balance and the liver is out of balance, we're gonna get changes going on in the brain, in the hypothalamus, in that suprachiasmatic nucleus. Metabolic disturbances associated with sleep loss may in fact be mediated through relative imbalances of specific gut bacteria, and end products of bacterial species which grow in response to sleep loss are able to induce fatigue. This is a very good review article. If you have a chance, take a look at it, from 2022, that really talks in good detail about the relationship between the brain and what's going on with the brain-gut microbiota axis. And in a testament to what's going on with the gut and how it affects the brain, right now we're looking at actually clinical studies that are going on through the NIH, looking at FMT, right, fecal microbiota transplant. And what they find in mice is that when you have sleep apnea mice and you take their microbiome and put them into healthy mice, the healthy mice start having sleep problems. And they're also showing that when you take healthy mice microbiota and put it into the mice with the sleep apnea, that they sleep better. So there's a very clear relationship there. And right now there is a study. If you go to clinicaltrials.gov, you can find that study. I'd be happy to send it to you as well. So we talked about a number of things: sleep, exercise, the environment, relaxation work, psychological work, foods, food timing, and digestion. Now we're going to talk a little bit about supplements. And I always like to preface the supplement section by saying that I think is vitally important to work on all those other things. Get a really good intake with the patient. Look at the lab testing. Put a plan together that's very thorough for diet and lifestyle. And then, of course, adding the right supplements can really take you over the top and help that patient improve and get the results that you're looking for. Some of my favorites include theanine, which is a biologically active component of green tea. Theanine does not have caffeine in it. In fact, the monks used to drink caffeine, green tea, when they would meditate, because it kept them awake from the caffeine, right? Binding to those adenosine receptors. And also theanine, which kept them calm. So they had this calm awakeness while they slept. Theanine is shown to increase alpha wave activity, which is the activity of the brain waves that you want to have before you fall asleep, that meditative state that really creates a healthy sleep, the beginning of a healthy sleep architecture. It's actually the foundation of it. And when we get into that alpha wave before we fall asleep, it's been shown that we will also have better sleep. Magnesium is an essential mineral and cofactor. Adequate magnesium is shown to support muscle and nerve function, and some evidence associates higher magnesium with improvements of sleep quality. But indeed, the research is limited. There are different forms of magnesium. For my patients, I will recommend different forms depending on what's going on. Tryptophan, which is an amino acid, which gets eventually converted into serotonin, which gets converted into melatonin. And it's been found in some small studies how maybe around a gram of tryptophan a day can significantly significantly shorter wake after sleep onset. So if you believe there might be a low serotonin situation, or in some patients you find that serotonin levels, when they're augmented, they can be helpful. Tryptophan can be a part of that. Sometimes a little vitamin B6 needs to be there as well. Sometimes vitamin D levels have to be proper. Zinc as well. All those things have to be in place to make proper levels of serotonin. Valerian is probably the most studied supplement of all time for sleep. 10 studies, even though there's a number of studies that have been looked at, even through meta-analysis, we're not actually finding anything very, very strong for valerian that's stronger than anecdotal evidence at this point. So it's kind of surprising, even though it's so well studied, there's a lot of methodological problems. Nevertheless, clinically and anecdotally, over the years, over the decades, I've heard from many other patients and many other doctors the benefits of working with valerian. It's considered from the American Botanical Council something that's grounding during emotional turbulence and for aiding in creativity, communication, and conflict. So valerian does not come from the word valium. It comes from the word valere, which is to be strong and healthy. So valerian might be a good choice. I like to warn my patients, it's a little stinky. So if they do it in a tincture or a capsule, it's going to smell a little bit. but despite the smell, I think it's worth trying as well. Melatonin. 23 randomized controlled trials, and this meta-analysis showed significant effect on sleep quality as assessed by the PSQI. It seems like it works a bit better for patients with more physiological issues like respiratory issues, metabolic issues, or primary sleep concerns. Believe it or not, less for more mental, mood, and neurocognitive concerns. So when there's more of a physiology behind it, it seems like melatonin has some benefits, but less for the mental, when there's mental concerns that are driving. And I've heard that because patients who are very, very stressed out or an event or something that happened to them when they got really stressed out, they'll tell me, oh yeah, I tried melatonin, it didn't really work for me, at least by itself. Having said that, sometimes you need to do melatonin with the diet and lifestyle recommendations that we talked about, and then you can get better results. This is a study actually I co-authored last year in the Pediatric Annals, which looks at the safety of melatonin even for children. And it finds that a very favorable safety profile. It's a review of 18 randomized controlled trials over 1,000 children, looking at melatonin in the short term, reported very infrequent adverse events. So despite some of the media hype that's going on around melatonin in children, it does seem to be a quite safe way in the short term to help support sleep while figuring out the underlying issues. Children in general have very, very high levels of melatonin, and arguably the levels of melatonin you would use in a child might actually need to be higher than what you'd even use in an adult. I haven't found that clinically, but theoretically that even makes sense. So cortisol, so when that patient we talked about earlier that has that very high cortisol level at night, there are a number of herbs very useful. Magnolia, which is a Japanese herb, along with phalendron, which is a supplement called Relora. Then there's ashwagandha, a phosphatidylserine. There's other studies that look at phosphatidylserine along with essential fatty acids to be very, very useful, supporting adrenal function as well. So in summary, magnesium, theanine, tryptophan, valerian, melatonin, and some of those cortisol calming herbs we talked about can be very helpful with sleep. And what you want to do is you want to understand what are the underlying issues for your particular patient. And then you want to pick and choose the ones that you think will address those issues most specifically. And that's really, I think, when we get the best results using supplements. And then of course, along with the diet and lifestyle recommendations. So we talked about medications, patient intake, lab testing, putting a plan together. We're going to finish up with the case recommendations, and we're going to finish talking about Charlotte now. So what was my initial recommendations for Charlotte? If you notice, I like writing down my recommendations very clearly and very specifically. I try not to do too many things. I try to keep it on one page, but make it very, very clear for patients, especially when they're having sleep concerns and they don't feel well. We want to make it as clear and as easy as possible. So for Charlotte, we decided to give her Laura at 8:30 in the evening, which is that magnolia phalangin blend, along with some progesterone cream at night. We made sure she kept the room dark and cool because she had mentioned that her room was not really dark. We want to make sure she's shutting those screens by 9:30 and getting ready for bed. I had her also do a little tilia or linden tea because she explained some palpation symptoms that I thought might be useful for to help just kind of calm her nervous system and her cardiovascular system a little bit. And then at 10 o'clock, take the melatonin, a 1 milligram as a lozenge, 20 minutes before bed. And if you notice, I even write down her schedule at night, like, okay, do this at 8:30, do this at 9:30, do this at 10. I find that when people have ritual, and it allows them to stick to it better. We started some recommendations of meditation, psychotherapy, of course, to talk about the stressors going on in her life and to help process those during the day, so her brain wouldn't have to process them at night or wake her up at night to think about them, which often happens, especially during stressful situations like the one she's going through. And then work on friendships because she was so busy in taking care of the kids. Her own relationships with other people were dwindling, and that's when she needed them the most. So we talked a bit about that, and we got her to do that. I talked about the benefits of hugging your friends and creating oxytocin in your body. So she started on that. Exercise, she got back to exercise, acupuncture for that kidney deficiency and heart fire that we saw in her tongue. We got her on a more Mediterranean style diet, especially working on the liver, because with that high estrogen, low progesterone, it seems like the liver wasn't metabolizing hormones properly, plus the fiber, to make sure the estrogen gets ushered out to keep more estrogen progesterone balance. We got her to do some half calves for the coffee in the morning and a green tea in the afternoon instead of that third coffee, because her genetics suggested that she probably didn't process it too well. And then avoiding the alcohol at night, instead trying chamomile tea, which I know sometimes at first when you're looking for alcohol and what it does, chamomile doesn't always suffice. But with the tilia, I think it was a nice choice for her and allowed her body to feel better and be calmer. And then some supplements, iron. She was a little deficient in iron, and that actually gave her some more energy. And DIM, which helps with estrogen metabolism as well. So we were kind of raising her progesterone and effectively lowering her estrogen at the same time. And she actually did well with this. We ended up doing a micronized progesterone because she wasn't 100% better. So she ended up taking 50 milligrams of oral micronized progesterone in the evening. And there's actually meta-analyses about the benefits of progesterone for sleep. And its benefits in GABA, in raising GABA in the brain. So that's always something you can go to. I like to start slower and see how people do, and then we ended up increasing it a little bit. And other than that, there were really no other changes. She did quite well. She was sleeping soundly probably within 6 weeks, and very happy about that. And she felt more able to take on the stressors that were going on in her life. So I also think the psychotherapy and the friendship cultivation had a lot to do with that as well. So I don't think it was just the supplements and my recommendations, but I think it was doing all of those things together that really made the difference for her. Okay, so in general, lifestyle recommendations, the right supplements, and the right testing to help us understand the underlying physiology. That seems to be what works for patients. It's very rare that there's a sleep patient that can't be helped, I think, in my opinion. I think sometimes when patients are already on kind of some of the heavy-duty medications, the trazodones, the Seroquels, the Z drugs for a long time, Sometimes it becomes a little more challenging because their bodies get kind of used to those medications, and some of those mechanisms that are available to us get shut down, you know, as receptors internalize. So do know that the patient that I had shared with you was not on medications. She was medication naive, and she came because she didn't want to take them. And that was, I think, helpful to getting her going a little faster. I think sometimes, you know, sleep medications, while they can be really valuable in the short term to help somebody feel better, they can make the actual recommendation plans a bit more challenging because there's more work to do. So, but absolutely worth doing that work. So again, I am Dr. Peter Bongiorno. That is my information. If you have any questions, I'm very, very happy to take emails if you want to connect with me, talk more about it. There are products and things that I didn't talk about in this webinar, which I'd be happy to share as well, that I also find really effective. These are my books. The one on the left, Holistic Solutions for Anxiety and Depression, that's for professionals, for doctors, for therapists. And then those two books next to them, How Come They're Happy and I'm Not, for low mood and depression, and then Put Anxiety Behind You as well. So yeah, please do connect with me on social media too. It's really my pleasure. I'm happy to take some questions, Paul, if that's something we can do now or we have any time for. Otherwise, I'm really happy to talk to you offline and share more information, or if you have information that you think I missed, I'm really happy to hear about it too, right? We all learn from each other. So that was really a pleasure. Thank you so much. And thank you to Pure Encapsulations and the Atrium Group for putting this on and having me here. It's really an honor.